Hi, so I'm going to be talking about decision support for precision medicine. And just to give you a little bit of background of where I'm coming from, my background's in biomedical informatics and public health genetics, where the work I'm going to be talking about is more on the side of how we're using information in applications of health, and then public health genetics really provides some of the context around genomic discoveries in terms of ethical, legal, and social implications. And that's in addition to some of the contextual considerations in healthcare settings. And the projects that are relevant to this presentation are one AHRQ-funded project to study genomic clinical decision support, and I'm also involved in a project called eMERGE, which involves several sites that have that are getting sequencing for their patients and returning those results. There will be a whole panel on precision medicine, but since I'm up here talking about this now, I'll just briefly go over one view of precision medicine as tailoring medical treatments to individual characteristics. It's commonly used in the context of genomic medicine, but we can think of it more broadly in terms of P4 medicine, which was coined by Leroy Hood in the Institute of Systems Biology, where he describes it as predictive, preventive, participatory, and personalized medicine. And just to demonstrate the contribution of genetics as well as other factors in health broadly, if you look at the 10 leading causes of mortality, you see that several of these have some aspect of genetics. So heart disease, cancer, Alzheimer's disease, so all these, many of these, not all of them, have some kind of genetic component. So that's partially why it's often considered within the context of genomic medicine. In addition, we're starting to hear more about this concept of learning healthcare system, where precision medicine is, we're wanting to use genomic data optimally as well as other types of data optimally, and based upon the what happens to in the care of patients, we want to constantly improve that process through a learning healthcare system, and implementation science is really monitoring what is effective, what is ineffective, as well as prior to implementing, understand what are the anticipated barriers and being able to mitigate some of those challenges. And I'm going to talk specifically about how we can use genomic data and how clinical decision support can help with that. So to give some background, a lot of the discussions that have come up so far have been around implementation within the context of healthcare settings and the work that's currently going on. So I thought it was worth going through the process of laboratory testing and how that might be considered within the context of genomics as well. So we see here on the top we have patient care, and prior to ordering a laboratory test is considered the pre-analytic phase, where there's a clinical question, a test can be selected, it's ordered, a specimen's collected, and then during the analytic phase, we have the sample is prepared and analyzed, and the result is verified. And once it's reported, we're in the post-analytic phase. The results, depending on the results, the clinician should be able to answer a question, an action is taken, and there should be an effect on the patient. And so where clinical decision support that I'm exploring fits is more around this, where a result is verified and reported, and providing the appropriate information that's needed to apply this to a patient. Now, within genomic medicine, there's also the consideration of if we already have genomic data available, then that changes this process a little bit, because then we're not ordering the test after the question, because the test results may be available and we're monitoring for changes. And it's one caveat. So there are several health IT challenges when delivering genetic services when thinking about this process. One, healthcare environments, as you've heard earlier, are complex, they're busy, and they involve many stakeholders. These are some of the stakeholders that are involved in this testing process. There's lab professionals, healthcare providers, patients, health IT professionals, and so on. Also, there's a dependence on vendor-specified clinical decision support capabilities often, where the EHR has certain capabilities. You may have heard of best practice alerts within Epic, so there may be certain things that are supported, but then also there's opportunities for open source technologies to interface with those and expand upon those capabilities as well. And there's also competing priorities of health IT professionals. And so some of these you've heard of before, so meaningful use requirements are something that are an external barrier that may influence how you're able to prioritize your efforts to implement clinical decision support. Also, clinical departments have requests, and how you prioritize those may depend. And there's institutional policy changes as well as other potential barriers. We've already heard about the information needs and how they can inform our design of technology. This is just an overview of a review article that describes some of this process. I'm going to talk mostly around about needs assessment, design validation, and how that this is an iterative process before developing a high fidelity prototype. I had an opportunity to work on a project that was led by Alan Schuldiner at University of Maryland, where they provided a precision medicine case study for patients that are getting a stent, and they are and the first line therapy is clopidogrel, and with genetic test results for CYP2C19, depending if they're independent or poor metabolizer, they may need to change the change to an alternative therapy like prasugrel. So there's several stakeholders that are involved in this project. There's interventional cardiologists, cardiac NPs, lab professionals, pharmacists, and research coordinators. And we've based our assessment on the existing guidelines that are available for how to react to genotype test results. And so in order to study this more, we connected focus groups with these different stakeholders. And to first understand what is the current genetic testing process that's occurring under study conditions, and also to understand the user experience in terms of usability, missing functionalities, problems proposed, and design features. So this is a process diagram that we prepared following their focus groups to really understand what was the current process. After doing this assessment, we also performed member checking to make sure what we imagined was what was real. And so this was done with a study coordination team that had a really good understanding of the entire process. So just to go through this, this is a business process diagram that has the roles as swim lanes here. So we have the healthcare providers at the top. The research team is the second row. Then we have the patient medical record here, the clinical laboratory, and then specialist genomic laboratory. So I don't know if you can see this so well, so I'm just going to walk through it briefly. So a patient would have would be indicated for candidacy for CYP2C19 testing, and at that point you would order the test, you would draw the blood, and that would be sent to this genomic laboratory. The results would be prepared preliminary by the technician, which would then be approved by a director, and then those results would be faxed and manually entered into the electronic health record data, electronic health record system. Also, they would be sent to the study team, which would prepare a letter that included the recommendations that would then be delivered to the care team. In addition, if there were actionable results, they would be called, the ordering clinician would be called to be notified of the test result, and the study team would directly contact the care team. So some of the main findings that we had when we asked about documentation was that entering information to the lab can be error prone, because we had this step where you receive a fax and then you manually enter it, so then it's structured results, which is good for clinical decision support, but there's a potential to have errors there. Oops. Just to emphasize that point, even within groups like eMERGE that are funded to return results, as well as CSER, results from genomic sequencing, we see that there's a large portion of those institutions that don't have structured discrete results. And so that also, that influences our ability to trigger clinical decision support based upon that result to tell the clinician what to do. And so this is just to illustrate that across several different types of genetic data types, it was 50% for the majority, 50% or below for the majority of these, with the exception of pharmacogenomics, which is high in comparison to other types of institutions. Also, in terms of viewing the treatment recommendation results within the lab report, we found that depending on the institution, whether you can include the recommendations within the lab report itself depends on whether the laboratory has the clinical information to interpret the genetic test results in the context of the patient. And so that was a consideration for this particular project, which seems relevant to other genetic testing as well. And then finally, in terms of notification, it was often that the incorrect clinicians can be notified because the ordering clinician was not always the same person who was treating the patient at the time the results are received. And so then we proposed areas where technology could potentially improve these processes. So we this just illustrates, you can see right away that it's fewer swim lanes. We have the healthcare providers, again, the EHR, the genomics lab, and our laboratory information system. And so we might have decision support within the EHR to notify the physician of candidacy. So the main difference here is that this is imagining what it would be like to move from a research protocol to clinical practice. And so there were several steps that were dependent upon the study team that aren't in this imagined process. And so we see that once the clinician is notified, they can order the test, draw the blood, perform the assay, and then the physician can perform a preliminary report. Once they do that, if we're able to have recommendations approved by some form of oversight committee, then it might be possible to include the recommendations directly into the lab report. And then this would be resulted in the EHR, and that would require having an interface between the laboratory system and the EHR, and then notifying the care team of the correct report. So all these steps would take some effort to identify, do we know who the care team is, and how will we be able to notify them when the test results is available, and whether they should make a change or not. And so these are the main points. Our next phase of the study, we were imagining how we might propose software, which we were calling Genomic Medicine Assistant, to be able to facilitate this process and enable the lab director to be able to approve of a lab result, which would then be accessible to the clinicians. And the focus, we ended up targeting clinicians and what they would want to see in terms of content, how they want to be notified. And so when we're designing this prototype, our main objective was to be able to develop a high fidelity prototype so that we would have clinicians interact with that. From the phase one that I described part of the results from, we also assessed content and information resources that clinicians want to have access to. And we created storybooks for each that included scenarios. One example scenario was when opening an encounter, the healthcare provider is notified that their patient is a carrier of a genetic variant that causes a reduction in ability to metabolize clopidogrel, and then the message contains a link to a report within this application called Genomic Medicine Assistant. And so this just provides an overview of the methods that we used. I went over the first phase one, also the scenario development, and then we iteratively designed the genomic medicine application. And in doing so, we got feedback from healthcare providers by conducting focus groups. There were two focus groups that we conducted with two different personalized medicine initiatives that were ongoing. One was around clopidogrel and CYP2C19, and the other one was around testing patients who were suspected for monogenic diabetes. And for each of those, we had different scenarios. And for the first part, we had them walk through storybooks and go through tasks and provide feedback, writing down what is their feedback on each of the screens. And then the second part of the focus group was a moderated-led discussion around that. So as a result, we came up with design principles for delivering genomic test reports to clinicians. And we were exploring the idea of multi-gene sequencing. So this is somewhat exploratory. But the two main categories of finding that we had when we did this was there were recommendations around timing and navigation, as well as content recommendation. And the three design principles that we identified were that customized notification was of interest, because depending on familiarity with the actual scenarios and the urgencies of the scenarios, they would want to be notified differently. So we had one notification approach was the best practice alert, which was interruptive, and it was different than the other approach that we illustrated around an inbox message, which was more of a passive approach to provide access to laboratory results. And then a second design principle was that everybody wanted access to genetic specialists, even if they were familiar with the scenario. There were differences in whether they would seek consultation or not. However, they wanted to be able to have that option. And I think of decision support broadly, where consultation is one form of decision support. So that would be something to consider when designing these approaches. And then the third thing was that user-specific information was brought up, because we had specialist clinicians. So we had cardiology fellows and endocrinology fellows that were doing this analysis. And many of them said that if they were non-specialist clinicians, they may need different types of test results or different types of explanation of the test results. So in summary, we uncovered many areas for existing genetic testing processes, and we proposed some recommendations for solving those problems. And we also used user-centered design methods to gather input on prototype software design, and we determined design principles that could be utilized by other researchers who are exploring these similar areas. So I wanted to acknowledge the funding, and these are the publications with all my co-authors that contributed significantly to this work, and also our advisory committee. So thank you.